Thank you for joining today's webinar, How to Deploy Istio on Multiple Sites for Cloud Bursting and Disaster Recovery Purposes. I'm Alex Stedman, Head of Marketing for EMEA and APAC here at D2IQ, and I will be your moderator for today's session. I'm joined by our sales engineer, Denis Genot. Denis will be discussing today why Service Mesh is becoming so popular, what is Istio, how to deploy Istio on multiple sites, how to use Istio for cloud bursting, and how to manage disaster recovery with Istio. But first, some quick housekeeping before we begin. We'd love to take some questions at the end of the session, so if you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into your ON24 chat box, and we will answer a few during the Q&A section. Without further ado, Denis, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Alex. Hi, everyone. So I've already been introduced by Alex, but you get also some contact information on the screen now if you want to take a look at some videos I did on this subject or other related subjects. You can go on the YouTube channel, and also if you want to connect with me, it will be a pleasure. So as Alex said, we'll go through why people use Service Mesh, why people use Istio, and we have, I would say, more than half of this webinar will be a live demo. So I will try to go quite fast on the slides and then focusing more on the demo and the practical side. So first of all, everyone has today a cloud-native journey and go from a monolithic application to microservices, so application where mainly in the past running in VM, and using like one relational database, for example, running on another VM. And now people tend to use a different approach with microservices. When we speak about microservices, generally we speak about containers. When we speak about containers, we speak about Docker. And when we speak about Docker and you start to go in production, then generally you have like a Kubernetes project. And then when you start to get more maturity, you start to have some need for service mesh, like I'll describe in a second. So you run your microservices, and you also use some data services because there is no microservice without data. So you need to have data services like Kafka to exchange messages between your microservices, or you need to persist your data in a NoSQL database or things like that. So the challenges with these microservices is how do you secure the communication between the different services. So I have a service one, service two, another microservice three. Perhaps or probably they are developed by different teams. Perhaps they are even developed with different languages, like one in Java, one in Kotlin, and so on. And then if you need to secure the communication between these services, that becomes quite difficult because you need to agree between the different teams responsible for these microservices about the way we secure the communication. And if you use different languages, it can be even more difficult. Then when the team responsible for the microservice 2 wants to introduce a new version, they have to think about how they do that without disruption, or they can just introduce a few instances of the new application, the new version. And then when they figure out that everything works quite well as expected, they can introduce more versions. So they have to define by themselves a way to introduce these new versions. They have to put in place some monitoring. And if each team is thinking about how to monitor or debug their application, they will use probably the most popular tools that are available in their language. And that means that it will be very difficult to get one a standardized way to monitor and debug the entire application. Each microservice will have its own way, which is something you want to avoid. So Service Mesh is solving this problem. The way it works is that you have this notion of reverse proxy. And you have all the communication between the microservice one, that is a front-end microservice, need to talk to a back-end microservice. It will go through a proxy. So this proxy will take care of encrypting the communication if you want. You will be able to define like some policies like this microservice can talk to this one, but not to this one, or nobody can talk to this microservice apart from the front-end microservice that is supposed to use its data. You can also introduce new version by telling this proxy to load balance the request across different versions of your backend microservice. And you can also, because all the communications are going through this proxy, you can collect all the logs and all the metrics and get all of these metrics in a standardized way that is similar for everyone. So Istio is one option for service mesh. It's probably currently the most popular one. Different approaches have been taken for service mesh. One, like Istio, which is to have a proxy per container. And another one that you see that is to have like one proxy per Kubernetes node. So you have pros and cons. If you have one proxy per container, then it's probably more secure because there is no communication that are not encrypted, even between the container and the host and so on. But if you do that way, then that means that you have more overhead because you need to allocate some resources for the proxy for each container. But this is the Istio way. Then you see now some alternatives emerging where they want to do that at the host level, but then less overhead, but also less granularity and so on. So you have always pros and cons. Istio capabilities, not surprisingly, it's very similar to what I described before. So being able to allow you to connect your microservices together, introducing new versions of your microservices, being able to secure your communication, to control which microservice can talk to which microservice, and being able to collect all the metrics and to simplify the monitoring of your application overall. So the architecture, you'll see that there are some control plane services with different names, Pilot, Galley, Citadel, Mixer. We won't go through the details of all of these ones. We'll go through them very quickly, but this is really not the purpose of this webinar. The purpose is really more to show you how you can deploy Istio in a way that you'll be prepared to manage disaster recoveries and bursting. But I still go through that very quickly. And as I discussed before, the approach you have with Istio is that you get one proxy per container, and all the communication are going through this proxy. And this proxy is also gathering all the metrics and then sending the metrics to the control plane so that you can get some insight from these metrics. When I say one proxy per container, it's not really per container, it's per pod. So with Kubernetes, the notion of pod is one pod can have several containers, even if in most of the cases you have like one container per pod. And that means that you can have like several containers sharing the same pod, and means that they can communicate together with localhost. They can access the same storage and so on. Really using this notion of pod, Istio can add another container in each pod, and this container is a proxy, and this proxy is allowing you to manage all the communications and so on. So to manage the traffic, you have this service called Pilot, where you just set some rules, and these rules are applied on Kubernetes. And as you can see here, in fact, Istio has not been developed only for Kubernetes at the beginning, and it's something I use with Mesos, Cloud Foundry, or other platforms, but definitely it is becoming more and more popular to use it on Kubernetes. You can also apply like policies and securities with, and this is done by this control plane and by these different services. So Pilot will make sure that everything is applied correctly. Citadel is managing all the certificates so that the proxies can communicate together and encrypt the traffic. And Mixer will collect all the metrics, for example, that are obtained by the proxy. So, as I said, the focus of this webinar is to look at how you can deploy Istio in a way that you can get disaster recovery and bursting. So when we speak about disaster recovery and bursting, obviously we speak about multi-sites. That can be two private clouds, one private cloud and one public cloud, two public clouds, whatever. But when you deploy Istio in multiple sites, then you have several ways to do it, several options. One option is to have two, let's say, separated Istio control planes, and they are independent. And then you define some DNS rules, or what we call service entries in Istio, to be able to or to enable communication between these two clusters. So what's nice with this approach is because you have two distinct Istio control planes, then if you lose one site, then that still works correctly. Obviously, you have to understand how to handle this failure, but this is independent, it has its own control plane as well. So that's really the best design if you want to get disaster recovery. So let's say you have like a private cloud with two data centers. You can say, I will do like one Istio with its own control plane on one of my data center and another one by my second data. The second option, which is to have only one control plane for multiple sites, is nice for bursting, because now you can say you want to launch additional instances of your microservice and you launch them in the second data center. But obviously, because you have only one control plane, if I lose this one on the left, then I cannot do anything anymore with my remaining cluster. That's why I say it's more for bursting. And in this case, you could imagine that your first cluster that is on your private cloud in your first data center, you can connect it to a public cloud here so that you get bursting capabilities. You can mix and match these two things. So you can have like your two data centers on premise where you have like one control plane on each one, in this picture. And then this one can also be connected to another one for bursting purpose. So really, it's really nice, flexible. You just need to understand well where to use which approach. But obviously, before you can deploy Istio, and as soon as you define that you want to use Istio on Kubernetes, then what you need is that you need a Kubernetes cluster, and you need something similar for the different types. So if you want to have like some Istio deployed in your private cloud, some others in another data center of your private cloud, and some others in AWS and for bursting, and perhaps in another region, Azure, for example, then you want to have like a similar experience on Kubernetes. And if you start to take one solution from one vendor on your data center and then use the managed service from AWS and the other one from Azure, then you will have a lot of different versions of Kubernetes, different ways of managing these Kubernetes clusters, and so on. So that's probably not something that will allow you to easily manage your environment. On the other side, what you can do is you can say, okay, I'll use this CNCF landscape map to build my own Kubernetes platform. And as soon as I do that, I can deploy that platform anywhere. I can decide to deploy it on premise. I can decide to deploy it on AWS, on, you know, just using EC2 instances, and same on Azure and so on. And to be able to do that, you have to go in this CNCF landscape and find out what are the different options for monitoring, for logging, and so on. And it takes a lot of time for you to figure out what components to use and how to integrate them together. And as soon as you are ready, then it becomes very painful to maintain it. So to upgrade each of these components and make sure that whenever you upgrade these components, you don't introduce a bug. And that means that you spend a lot of time just like trying to maintain your platform. And every time you have a security bug that's detected, it takes time for you to put that in production. So that's why at D2IQ, we have launched this platform called Convoy, which is basically exactly the same as what you would have done yourself. So selected the most popular software like Grafana and Prometheus for monitoring, and Elastic and Kibana for logging, Velero for the backup, and Traffic for Ingress. So basically like the most popular open source software that people use when they want to build their own platform. But in this case, you get everything already integrated and you get a full support from us, from one vendor, and everything is maintained so you don't have to manage the integration of all the new versions and so on. So that's what we will use for this demo. And just for information, we also provide some training that allows you to pass the TKA certification, which is really the certification people pass when they want to operate Kubernetes cluster, or the CKD certification, which is the one that people pass when they want to develop application that will run Kubernetes, which is really important because you really want, as a developer, to understand the way your application will run so that you develop it in a way that is compatible with the platform where you want to run it. So that's it for the slides. As I said, I didn't want to go and spend too much time on the slides. So we'll go through the demo, and in this demo, we'll focus more on this disaster recovery capability. So what I've done is that I've deployed two Kubernetes clusters, and that's it. So nothing else is deployed currently. We'll go from zero, so just two Kubernetes clusters, to deploy Istio on both sides, deploy the services on both sides, and look at how all of these microservices can talk together, look at how you can manage the failure of one microservice, and so on. So what I did, just deployed here several Kubernetes clusters using Commander, which is another software that we are currently providing in beta but releasing soon, and you see there is an Istio thing here, so if you want to know more about what's coming there, don't hesitate to contact us, and we'll go through more details. But for the sake of this demo, what I did is that I deployed like two Kubernetes clusters using Convoy. One is in two clusters are in version 1.15.5 of Kubernetes, quite recent, and nothing is deployed on this cluster. So I've been able to just deploy like get the kubeconfig file from there, and then I'm starting from scratch. So I'll go through two things. The first will be deploying Istio in these clusters, and then doing the different tests to manage like the disaster recovery and so on. So first of all, I have two kubeconfig files, one for each cluster. So I'll just like export these environment variables, and then I'll deploy Istio on each of these clusters. So I just do that for the first one, and I'll explain you what is being done while it is running. So you see here, first thing I do, just like create a namespace, create some certificate. Then you just like create some CRDs, so custom resource definitions. If you are not familiar with Kubernetes or with CRDs in Kubernetes, you see that more and more it's just a way to create additional Kubernetes objects, and Istio is using that a lot. As you can see, we expect that we'll have 29 new objects for Istio. Then we'll deploy Istio with this multi-cluster template. So really just like the basic deployment without anything special. You see it is currently being deployed here. And as soon as it will be done for one cluster, I just run exactly the same command here to deploy my seven cluster. See where I stopped here. Kubeconfig 2, or I just go there, just copy and paste that as soon as it will be finished, which will be the case in a few seconds, I expect. And you'll see it's also deploying like gateways, and these gateways will be really important in the way the connection will be done between the microservices of our two sites. And I'll show you what I do with sites so that it will be easier to follow. So we start with communication between one microservice on one site to another one, and then we go through active-active deployment and disaster recovery and so on. So you see it's currently being deployed on the first site, so I can paste the same for my second cluster, and I get Istio deployed there as well. And what you see here that is quite interesting is this Istio ingress gateway here, that is part of the Istio deployment. And it's quite important because if I go back to this slide, you see that all the communication between this site and this site here will go through this Istio gateway. So basically, this is the only requirement. You don't need to have like all the machines running there, all the Kubernetes nodes there. You don't need to communicate with the Kubernetes nodes there. They just have to be able to communicate with this gateway. It was not the case in the past. I would say 6 months ago, there was no option to use this Istio gateway between the two sites, so it was a little bit messy. You would have to open all the communication, so it's a lot better now with this approach. So again, it's deploying the cluster, Istio cluster on the second Kubernetes cluster. And what we need now here to be able to communicate between one site and another is to update the DNS, so that, you know, in Kubernetes there is a DNS that allows you to communicate between services quite easily. If you know the name of the Kubernetes service and the name of the namespace, then you can reach it from any pod in the cluster. So that's because you have a DNS running on Kubernetes itself. But what we do here is that we are updating this DNS on Kubernetes to say that everything that will be .global will be sent to Istio, because in Istio there is also a DNS. So all the requests for something .global will be redirected to the Istio DNS. So you do that again on the two sides. Doing that for the first one, and then doing that for the second one. And what I'm doing now is not very special. It's really what you would see in the documentation here if you would follow the definition about how to deploy the multi-site Istio. What will be very new compared to the documentation is what we will see after, is how to manage disaster recovery, how to manage active-active. All these things are not documented. So that's what you will really learn from this webcast. So now that I have my Istio running on both sites, what I'm going to do is to demonstrate that I have this service here will be able to communicate with this service that is on the other side. So I'll create first a service that goes LIP, which is the one on the left side that will be running on my Istio cluster in the first site. And I see this is the pod name. And then I'll create the other one on the second site. So now I have one microservice here, another microservice there, but they cannot communicate together yet for the moment. They are just independent microservices. So what I need now is that I need to know the this gateway, what is the IP address or the host name of the gateway. So I get that using this command, so just kubectl command running on the second cluster that will give me this name, and that will display it. This is the name there. And now what I do is that I will create a service entry in the Istio DNS. So as I said, everything that's global is sent by Kubernetes to the Istio DNS. So here I will create a new entry that will be HTTP bin dot bar, bar is my namespace, dot global. And I say, if I have a request for that host, then I want to send it to the gateway of my second cluster so that it will be served by my second cluster. So that's really where the magic happens. So I just create this service entry. And if everything goes well, now I can execute this command from the slip pod, so from this one, to do a curl on this one using this global name, HTTP bin.bar global. Just doing that, I should have a 200 response code. That's true, I have a 200 response code here. So you see, I've been able to communicate between my different services. So that's the first thing, and again, this is what you find in the documentation. Everything new will start from now on. So what I'll do now is that we'll go through the second thing, which is, what if I want to have this microservice running on the two sides? So it will be more like a bursting example here. Even if I use this approach with two different control planes, you can still do bursting. So I'll show you that now. So if I want to do that, first of all, I need to have this microservice running also on the first cluster, which is what I'm doing here. And then I will need to add the gateway of the first site, because like you can see here, I want to be able to send a request there if I want to go to the other site, or to this gateway if I want to go to the local site. So just get, again, the host name of the gateway on my first site, and creating or just updating the service entry I created before, and just adding a second address, which is the address of my other cluster. So now, what will happen is that if I send the same request I did before, it will go to the two microservices, but I want to prove that. And to be able to prove that, what you can do is that you can enable access log, so that all the proxies will gather the access log, and you will be able to see that requests have been sent to this or this microservice. So that will be nice, because then I'd be able to prove that requests are not only sent to the second side, but now they're also sent to the first side. Sometimes you have to run it several times, because it takes a little bit of time to enable the access. But anyway, I will start now to try it. So I'll just run like four requests, the same as before. So doing a curl from this container here to the global entry of my other microservice. And my expectation is that I will be able to see access on both sides. So I send four requests, and I see one is going through, two, three, and four. So if I go now and I use this command, I can look at the access logs, because I use the Istio proxy log. So I just get the logs of this one, first proxy, which is on the first site, and I see I got here three requests. And if I go and look at the access logs, so it was around like 3 p.m. And you see, I see also here one request. So it sends three requests to one and two requests to the other one. Then what you want to do is, okay, what about having an active deployment, in fact? So that if I want to be prepared for disaster recovery and I want my application to still be running correctly, then the best thing is I have all my microservices running on both sides. And then What I need here is to start this service on the second site first. So that's the first step. I start this sleep microservice here. And the second thing I need to do is that I need to create this service entry on the second site, because as I said, the Istio control planes are independent on both sides. So I need to create the same service entry on the second site. And again, this service entry also refer to the two gateways. Then what I should be able to do is to send out the request from the sleep microservice here to this global entry, and that should see communication going through these two microservices. I need to get the sleep pod of the second site, and then I send for request again. And because I have the access logs enabled, I can go there and see how many requests I got from on the first site. And I see 303, and I see that here I got one request on the site. So I try to balance. It's not absolutely equal because we use only four requests. If we would have sent like 100 requests, then you would see close to 50-50. So I'm now going to work on this disaster recovery. So what happens if I lose that site? So if I lose that site, what I want to do to be able to simulate that, I need to be able to, I could just destroy my Kubernetes cluster, but there is another way that is a little bit easier, is just to make sure that you, this cluster cannot communicate to this IO gateway anymore. So the way I'll do that is that I'll take the gateway host name here, and I'm going to my AWS account here, looking for this load balancer. If I am not disconnected, yes. And if I look at the listener, I see that there is here this one. That I want to disable, and it is going to this one. I just take note of it to be able to reconnect it later. I just remove that, click on save. So now my first cluster cannot communicate with my second cluster anymore. And I will use my sleep pod that is on my first site, you can see here. And again, I send my phone request. And this time, if everything goes well, I should be able to continue to communicate with my HTTPB microservice using the instances that are running on my first site. You see, I get like 200 response calls, which is nice because I lost my site, but still, my application is working well. And if I look at my access logs, obviously I will see the four requests on that site. You see the four requests came there. So what I can do now is that I can just like reconnect that. So add back these things here. And I can go through the other thing. So now they can communicate back together. What I'm going to do is to show you that you can also use Wait to manage the load on both sides. And that's more a cloud bursting use case, because you can say, okay, I have like most of my requests going to my local data center, but I want to have now some of them going to the other side. And basically you can monitor perhaps your metrics from your application and based on some metrics, you can change the weight dynamically so that you can get more requests going to the public cloud, for example. So what I'm going to do here, just first of all, just making sure that now that I have reconnected everything, I can still see my request going on both sides. That would be the number one check I need to do. So again, to go after through the access log. I just do with four requests, as I said before, it's not ideal, but just to make the demo easier to digest. So I see here some requests coming and there. Yeah, in fact, it just sent all to the third, the second type, which is fine because it just proved that the second time is back. But what I will show you here, it's difficult to prove. It's more really for information about showing how it works. Because you see now I have added the weight here. So I should see more requests going to the first one, to the first type compared to the second type. Again, not sure we'll be able to really see it in practice because I send only four requests to check that. And you need a lot more requests to be able to really see the effect of this weight. But if we are lucky, we'll see more requests going on the first side. You see, yeah, I see three, so it put three on the first and one on the second, which is what I was expecting. It's not always the case because, as I said, for this small number of requests is not really always enough to prove it. But it was okay this time, so that's cool. Last thing is that you see here my requests from this microservice to this microservice, they are on the same site, but they go through the gateway, which doesn't make sense because you go through the internet or whatever communication, that is not really optimized. Everything goes through this gateway, and you don't really want that. So you can configure that in a better way, where when I send a request to the other side, I go through the entire gateway, but if I send them on the local side, then I want to go local. And I will demonstrate just that part on the left, the same on the right part. So to do that, what you get here is that you try to get the service, so the Istio ingress gateway service, and you try to get the cluster IP, not the load balanced IP, but the local one, and the same for the port. So you just get this local cluster IP and port, and then you just update your service entry so that for the local cluster, I use the cluster IP in the local port. For the second cluster, I use the TTF gateway. So again, just going through that, updating this. And now I can send my four requests here. And nothing should have changed. I mean, I just need to make sure that I got at least one request on the first set. So sending four of them here. And I see here that, yeah, I got one. So that concludes the demo. Again, you could see a lot more than that on Istio. There are a lot of things I didn't speak about, like there is a very nice UI called Kiali. You can just get it deployed when you deploy Istio. It's just like one parameter to add and you get it. And it's really nice because then you can see your microservices and the communications. You know, everything is really coming with nice visualization and so on. I just didn't want to go through all of the details because I really wanted to focus on how to deploy Istio in a kind of production-ready way. So meaning like how you manage like multi-site with disaster recovery and bursting. Another thing I didn't cover in this webinar is how to deploy these different services with high availability, which is not the case when you deploy the Istio by default. If I just look at the way the different components are deployed on the IO system namespace, you'll see that a lot of these control plane components are not even coming with multiple instances, which obviously is not a good practice. So if I do like that, it won't be.
Thanks, Denis. Apologies.
Citadel
is
only
with one. Can you go on mute, please?
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, there you go. Great. I just wanted to thank you for an amazing presentation and an excellent demo, and explain that now we'll take a few minutes for some Q&A, and we already have some questions in the Q&A section, so thank you everyone who has submitted your questions. I will also flag to you everyone where that is, so you can see it. There you are. Great. And the first question is, what Kubernetes platform did you use for the demo?
Oh, yeah. So I covered that very quickly. But I'm using like Convoy, which is our platform, our Kubernetes platform for from D2AQ. And I deployed this Convoy platform using another software called Commander, which allows us to deploy Kubernetes clusters easily in different clouds and so on, stuff like that.
Great, thanks. And our second question is, do you plan to have a proper Istio integration in the future?
Yeah, so that's a good question. I went through that very quickly, just saying that it is a little bit. There is a button that is great currently in the Commander software, and that's called Istio Mesh, and it is there because it's something we are working on. I won't go through the details, but we are planning to not only automate the deployment of Istio, but also making it easier to manage Istio with multiple sites. And as I was just saying at the end of my presentation, when you deploy Istio following the documentation, it doesn't even provide any high availability because you have only one instance of each control plane service and so on. So we are kind of working on providing like a production-ready Istio with multi-site support and so on. So we will provide more information very soon, but if you're interested, don't hesitate to contact us.
Great, and perfectly on time. Thanks, everyone. That's all the time we have for today. I want to thank everyone again for taking the time to attend, and a special thanks, of course, to Denis and everyone who submitted questions during the Q&A. The webinar will be on demand within the next 24 hours, and we will include links to the recording in a follow-up email. And if you enjoyed this webinar, please join us next Monday at the same time, 3:30 p.m. CET, for our webinar, Persistent Storage with Portworx on Kubernetes. The link to register is in the group chat. And, of course, on our website, d2iq.com. Please take a moment to fill out the survey on the left-hand side of your screen. Thanks again for attending. This concludes the webinar.